how I feel right now. I don't wanna take no time to write this down. I wanna tell you how I feel right now. Hey, tomorrow may never come for you or me. Life is not promised. Tomorrow may never show up for you and me. This life is not promised. I ain't no perfect man. I'm trying to do the best that I can with what it is I have. I ain't no perfect man. I'm trying to do the best that I can with what it is I have. Put my heart and soul into the song. Feel me from where I am to wherever you are. I mean that sincerely. Tomorrow may never come for you and me. Life is not promised. Tomorrow may never appear. You better hold this very moment. Sometimes I just want a quiet life. Me and my baby, me and my lady. Sometimes I don't want to get into no ball. Sometimes I don't want to be a soldier. Sometimes I just want to be a man. But homie said, shine your light on the world. Shine your light for the world to see. My hobby said, shine your light on the world. Shine your light for the world to see.
Hey guys, what is up? Happy Monday. My name is Gia Dett. If you're just joining for the first time, the Dett stands for Detroit. And I have a very special guest with me. I'm going to introduce him in a second. But before I do, like I said, this is Make Me Feel It Monday. Sometimes I play house music and other times I have the honor of interviewing guests from, I would say, my community. So shout out to everybody that's here. We got Mona M in the house, TC Bud and Muse, Rev Mac Live, Nathaniel, LaSonia Genovese, Dream Warrior, Tasia, Sleazy Jamie, That Boy Flo, Rogar. I didn't shout you out in the chat. I'm going to shout you out. And anybody else? Boxy Blanco, can't forget about him. I Still Rap. My Melanin Moods is in the house. Good to see you. The Mob is here with the red flags. It's so good to see everybody, y'all. So, like I said, I have a very special guest. His name is James, and he's an artist, a brand creator, an illustrator, photographer, videographer, interior designer, businessman, entrepreneur, et cetera, et cetera. And what I've noticed is that he's extremely passionate about the beauty of Blackness and its diversity in Detroit specifically and worldwide. And I've noticed that, James, you've curated a brand with a following of over 30,000 followers with your two pages on Instagram alone. I haven't checked your Facebook, but you've also engaged with various celebrities who have worn your brand and reposted and purchased your creations. Yet and still, you find new inspiration, and I can attest to this because I've been photographed and illustrated by you, and you've brought out so much beauty within my own melanin and the complexion of others every single time. So I do respect your raw talent, and you've honed it as well as an artist, and you are a voice for the culture. I'm extremely happy to welcome you to the AMP community. Everybody give him a round of applause.
Wow, that's a great introduction. And honestly, I feel very honored and humbled. And thank you so much for everyone here at the AMP family. And you would think that considering no one can see my face that I wouldn't be so nervous considering that I go on IG Live, it seems like every other day, but I had to like collect myself, woosah myself and drink plenty of water.
I feel you. So,
yeah, but thank you so much, G. I really appreciate this. This is any chance I get to talk about the creative journey and everything, I'm always for it. So thank you so much for having me.
Definitely. It's an honor. I think, you know, the world needs to know, even as if you haven't gone viral already, but more of the world can know about you. So James, like, how do you introduce yourself? Because I'm like, you go by your whole name, but how do you introduce yourself to the world when people are meeting you?
Simply James. When it is time to network, I do include the Charles, and that sort of became my business pseudonym. Even though it is my full name, Charles is the name that I got from my grandfather, Charles Pryor. And he was the businessman in the family, the entrepreneur, the man who had a sixth grade education and was able to do things that, you know, what created so much impact within the community and, you know, for our family. So I wear that with honor, as well as, you know, James, which is, you know, the name that I got from my father. And, you know, I just find strength in those two men who, you know, ultimately were very big influences. One who I saw every day for 23 years and one who I never met, but heard stories and, you know, from there, paint, you know, pretty much put together the picture. So, but yeah, it's, I know there's a long, you know, answer to it, but it's mostly James. And I just introduced myself as a visual artist to the people.
Okay, well, we have time today. That's cool. So it's a strong legacy. That's so cool. Yeah. I love that. So what is your origin story? That's a huge question, but I guess what led you to develop this passion for art and design and so much more?
You know, what's funny is I have been doing a lot of family archiving over the last, I want to say year and a half. And one of the things I've really been digging deep into is family videos. And there's a video of me when I was about a year old playing with my cousin, who's 4 years my senior. And we were in the kitchen over at my house stacking these food cans. And in this video, you just see me 1 year old, you know, just like, yay, every time we stack a can and make something new out of this, you know, like, and then even when the can fail, I'm still, yay. But I told someone in an interview that I think that is a moment that I was intrigued by creating something out of nothing. And it's just one of those things that I believe has been in me since I was a child. And as far back as I can remember, as far as age-wise, I would say between 5, 6 years old when I really started to, it basically started with seeing things on TV or when I would read something, and I would just be intrigued to create something out of it, whether it's looking at Disney's Robin Hood and deciding, oh, I want to go ahead and make my own Robin Hood figures, or Back to the Future, being intrigued by the DeLorean and actually building like the DeLorean time machine out of like tin foil and duct tape. So it's just a lot of things that really was like, it just like, and true story. So I was so intrigued by Back to the Future that I actually recreated the whole, like, what is it? The climax, you know, like the DeLorean going down the Hill Valley streets and the lightning striking the clock tower. So I actually built the clock tower, you know, of course, the DeLorean, and actually made the streets and the road. Now, also imagine the fact that I'm very detail oriented. So I actually took duct tape and placed it on the wood floor to actually recreate the streets. To this day, I don't know how the hell I didn't get, you know,
a woman. How old were you?
Well, I was probably like 6 or 7 at that time.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
Yeah. It was that early, and it just grew, like it never stopped. I mean, honestly, I know we're going to get into the collages and everything, but what I've been doing lately with my work has sort of taken me back to that time where, like, there were moments that I just, I don't know, I feel like I got lost in the sauce and was just really going through a lot of growing pains, like in my, you know, like my 20s and 30s, early 30s, and I was just all over the place, you know, just like, okay. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing, dude. And but
you didn't think you were, because it seemed like you were doing your thing.
Look, and I'm probably answering questions before you answer them, but okay. But yeah, just so everybody knows, like we're doing like what's my man's name, the director from Tenet and Dark Knight, Christopher Nolan. So we're doing like a Christopher Nolan thing where we're jumping like back and forth between things. So just to bring context, I, as Gia mentioned, entrepreneur. I had a shop downtown Detroit for years, 10 years. And the one thing about that was that it was always a dream for me to open up, you know, my own business. I enjoyed that period. I enjoyed designing pieces for that store. A lot of great things happened, but I really was not happy. You know, like towards the end of that shop, I really was like mentally going through withdrawal. Like there would be days I wouldn't want to come to the shop, and then dealing with, you know, the change in demographic, the ownership, everything, and it just was a lot, you know. And I've never really shared the story of why I closed up the shop, but it really was, I was going through a lot, and what happened was I was filling those, you know, those things, those sort of holes with, I guess you would say, the idea of certain things. So basically, it's like, whether it be people, whether it be, thank God I didn't get into drugs, anything like that, you know, but it was just a lot of things where there was emptiness that I was looking to fill with other people, other things, and I was just totally messed up. And it's funny because even during that period, I got baptized and I was like, oh yeah, this will change everything. And it's like, I mean,
temporarily, perhaps, like in that moment.
The water dries up, you know, like, and if you're not constantly watering yourself, you know, like the roots start to get a little bit shriveled too as well. But it really was like a period where I was trying to find my way back to that kid, because that kid had no fear. That kid, you know, could do anything, and he didn't allow other people, other entities, you know, like I've had many conversations with my mother about this. I wouldn't let the enemy defeat me, pretty much. Like, the enemy never mattered. And so of all things, it took a pandemic to have my come to Jesus moment.
Wow.
And
yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
I was just saying, yes, I feel like we all did in some way. You know, we had to sit with ourselves and see what was most important in life and truly unpack things that we were avoiding. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was like, it was just sort of a moment where a few things happened. One, it sat me down. DSE didn't matter at that point. I couldn't order supplies. I couldn't do photo shoots. So DSE literally was just like, okay. You don't worry about it. You know, it's over here. And I had to sit with myself many a days, you know, like, then another thing happened. I blew out my back, you know, during that period. So I spent about a good week where I was bedridden. And how I actually ended up, you know, like getting better was, I remember I was trying to walk to Whole Foods and I couldn't walk. And I started crying. I'm just like, God, like this. No, I don't want to be like this. I don't want to be like this. You know, and then I fall asleep and then I wake up an hour later and all of a sudden I sneeze and I just felt my back just like, oh my God. And then I turned around and then realized that popped my back right back in place.
Oh, okay. Look at God.
Yeah. Oh, I called that the sneeze from God because that was just like, oh, okay. So that was one thing. And then also and it's also cool, you know, like full circle that I'm having this conversation with the DJ. Because it literally was a DJ that saved my life, D Nice.
Oh yeah, I remember you like kind of, I felt like you mentioned that, and yeah, for sure. That's what's up. So where were you? You were on, was it Club Quarantine Radio or something like that?
Mm-hmm. So what it was when he first started doing, because I think at the time it was called, homeschool. So he would play records. And he would, you know, sort of give the history behind certain records and stuff like that. So, but he eventually got to the point where he was just doing straight sets. And I think I tuned in, it was either night three or night four. And I think at that time, I think he had ended up getting about 5,000 people tuning in. And I was like, oh, wow, this is really something. And then he went on the next night. I think about 10,000 came in that night. So I'm like, or, you know, concurrently or whatever. But he was touching so many folks that I said, you know what, I want to make something just to share amongst, you know, the community, be like, yo, I danced at Club Quarantine with D Nice. So I made this design, shared it with, you know, my IG community on DSE. The next night, that's when he hit like the mother load, when he hit like 500,000, when he had everybody in their
mind
in there. And and that's when it really like took off. So people were like tagging D Nice, like, yo, like, you need to see this. Funny enough, D Nice was already following the DSC page. So when he saw it, he's like, yo, hit me up. And we had a long conversation on the phone. We talked about life, you know, everything. And then we finally got to the design. And in my mind, I'm going back DSC, you know, printing, but I'm like, yo, I really don't want to print these shirts. So he just offered to, you know, acquire the design. And from that, I'm not going to say how much it was, but basically he put me in a place where during this time of, uneasiness, I didn't have to worry financially about what was going to happen over the next few months. So.
Wow, James. Like, okay, sorry.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
I was just going to say, just your creativity and those like destiny moments, so many of those in your life, but keep going. I'm sorry.
No, you're good. So within a week after the acquisition, that's when I started sitting down in my computer. Cause at this point my mind is at ease. So I just start going through all of my photos. And I think I was just trying to see, was there anything maybe I could post on IG? And then I ended up coming back to this collage that I did a year earlier that I was like, you know what, let me just do some more of these. And the next thing I know, I'm on my computer and there's this image that I captured of this stylist who unfortunately has passed on. His name was Dapper Africa. I captured him in New York and it was a beautiful picture of him, you know, sort of looking up into the sky. And in the style of what I did with that first collage, I created a collage of him, shared it online. And of course, in my mind, I'm like, you know, I'm just doing this because I want to do it. So I just started making another and another. And within 2 weeks, I think I made like about 20 collages.
Oh, wow.
So it was just like nonstop. Like in some cases, it was like 3 collages a day. And the next thing I know, it just slowly started to build momentum. And, you know, you were talking about the following, like I pretty much was just sort of like, I was fine with how many followers I had on my photo page. Cause I think at the time it was like maybe 1800 or 2000. And, you know, since then, I don't know what the count is now, but I know it's somewhere close to around 17,000. So
definitely.
Yeah.
Wow. Ah, you said so many amazing things there. Just how you turned that whole experience around, how you had to sit with yourself and how your back blew out, but it popped back in place. And then D-Nice, you know, you tuned in, he filled your spirit with some amazing sounds. And it almost like charged you. It charged you up to create, and then you spit out a creation. And then he, you know, he respected your creation, you know, with what you deserve and, you know, the monetary wise. And then you started creating more. So I think that's super dope. It just definitely speaks to your passion and your drive. So let's play some songs though. So do you have any order? I'm just going to play them in the order you gave me. That's okay.
You know what? A Love Supreme is the first song. So yeah, that's a great way to start off. So.
Okay, let's play it. And when we come back, if you have any words or if you want to maybe talk about why you chose it, let's do that. Okay?
Okay, sounds good.
Hey guys, welcome back to Yadette. If you're just joining, I have a very special guest, James Charles. You guys, before he answers why he chose that song, I do want to just shout out a few people that came through. We got Pastor Pat Conquers Troops, Shake Radio, Namari's in the house, Arturian came through, and I believe D. Michael is in the house too. Also, Dr. Purge is here, and Music. Shout out to Music. He said, James, thank you for joining. Looking forward to your future work and looking into your print pieces online. So yes, we love it. But James, why did you choose that song?
Love Supreme. First off, that whole album is, you know, to me, is probably one of the most sonically uplifting albums ever recorded. Coltrane at that time had went through, you know, a dark period in his life. And he was making that piece, that composition as his way of giving honor to God. In fact, the Love Supreme is pretty much, it's God's love. And and why that album is so important to me is I've gone through periods where it's like, oh, it sounds nice, to, oh, wow, like, where does this take me, to, I get exactly why, and it, you know, and sonically why it exists. And it's one of those albums that if I'm ever in a place where, you know, I just need that, you know, that nourishment to sort of get me moving, I'll turn that on, and immediately it's just like, boom, I'm right where I need to be. And there's another track. I don't know if the listeners were ready for it, but I was deciding between either that or Afro Blue Live at Birdland. Because there's a moment where, you know, Coltrane sort of intros in, and then you have McCoy Tyner, who's his pianist at that time of the classic quartet, who's playing, and he sort of has this very, like, he's building us up. So like he's playing very lightly, and he just slowly continues to like just build up, and it just gets louder and louder and louder and louder. And then it sets Coltrane up to come in with just the loudest screech. And every time I get goosebumps thinking about it, every time I hear it, I'm just like, woo! You know, it's like, if I could fly off the, what you call it, off the ground, that's exactly where I feel every time I hear that just charge. Cause he's just like, he's taking you there. And I'm very big on sound, on vibrational, you know, like feeling, and music that takes me there, where I can just close my eyes and I can vividly start to see what's in front of me, it becomes very necessary. Like these days I rarely listen to music that that has words, unless it's something that really is charging. So
wow. So that track you just described, was that by Coltrane as well?
It was, yes.
So
go ahead. Sorry.
I was gonna say, what are your three go-to tracks then? It sounds like you said that track we just played, another Coltrane track. Is there another one that really inspires you as well?
So there's a version of Fantasy by Earth, Wind & Fire, and it's the 12-inch edition. And it's rarely been heard, but I remember, I will never forget it. I was riding coincidentally to DSE, and I think it was playing on a 92.3, Mix 92.3 in Detroit. And it was first time I've heard this full long, extended version. And it, again, it's another one of those, you bring the instruments in one by one by one. But it's just, I mean, it's again, the lyrics, one are uplifting. The music is just absolutely beautiful. I mean, Maurice White did his thing as far as, composing this, this track. But yeah, those three are probably my go-tos.
Wow, love that. I wish we had the fantasy song. We could play that next. But yeah,
Oh, I
shout
think I
out to, oh, did you choose that as well? Let's see.
I did
I'm
it,
looking.
yes.
Okay, let's play that then. I'm looking. I am not seeing it. You said by Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah, so if it is on there, it should be right after the song "I Am the Black Gold of the Sun." If not,
Okay,
then
I actually don't have it. Okay, dang. I know. Look, let me go find it right now. Fantasy.
that's my bad. But yeah,
Oh.
I'll fill in the banter. So yes, Fantasy by Earth, Wind, and Fire was made by Duchess. So, I don't
Okay,
know.
I got it.
So,
I got it. I got it.
all right,
But
cool.
y'all, shout out to Critty Time, who is in the building. And the highlighter god is in the building. But yeah, they're excited to hear fantasy. So we're gonna go ahead and play that up
That's
next.
good. Thank you.
You guys are making me laugh in the chat. Shout out to Boxy and Mona and Hello Kath. What is this investigation that we are exploring? I'm curious. But yes, and music is just commenting on your selection, Shane. He's like, no groups are singing this pitch, holding notes for this long, shame. And then he also mentioned that he enjoys the longer version of that song as well. And Mona M was like, I wish we had amp during the pandemic. It would have been amazing for sure. But I have my special guest, James. Thanks for choosing that song. I would like to know, so you kind of mentioned just the different phases of your artistry and kind of like honestly honoring just your heart, honoring what you feel in that time, honoring what you should do in that time, right? But I guess what type of artistry do you enjoy the most? I mean, you know, it's you're a brand owner, you do photography, you do collages, you paint, you actually do interior design as well. Like, what do you enjoy the most?
First off, the interior design, you know, like it's like a temporary condition. I just so happened to get into that, but you know, but I appreciate that too as well. But no, honestly, what I've learned to enjoy about artistry is allowing yourself to. It was funny. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and we were just talking about a particular piece that they actually had purchased. And, you know, I was just talking more so about the process and everything. And what they ended up saying was, it's almost like you give yourself permission to play. And what that means is there are moments that sometimes you can get in your own way. Like there's this song by, Kid Cudi that features Andre 3000. And there's one particular lyric that I love, and it's, when you think too much, you're removing what's moving. And I just thought so hard about that, you know, as far as just how many times we just overthink ourselves into, you know, the doubt, into, you know, these moments where we can't even move, where we're just like, you know, why am I doing this? Oh, well, if I do this, then such and such, such will happen, or this, that, and the third. And it's like the consequences. And as opposed to thinking about, the benefits. So anything that allows me to be in the moment, which is photography, the collage comes from the photography. And all of that comes from being in a place where I don't think about it other than just, you know, how am I going to get to wherever I need to go? And sometimes it's sort of like there's right now on my desk, which has been my work desk for God knows how long. And there are two, like actual descriptions, and both written like in different times. But one said, get to NYC and get to Vegas. And those in particular were moments where I was, you know, scheduled to go to NYC for, I think, Afropunk, and then to Vegas for the Grammy Awards. And both times I was just sort of like, you really are like balling on a budget on this one. Like you really shouldn't be trying to go out there. But my whole thing was like, dude, just get out there. You know, like whatever happens at this point, like let it happen. But be there, be present. And the one beautiful thing about when I'm creating is that I'm present in the flow. Whatever happens in between that, like time does not matter anymore. you know, anything else is just is irrelevant because I'm in that creative flow that, you know, that I believe I was called to do. So when I'm allowed to play, it's like I have fun.
Nice. Yeah, it's nothing like that creative flow. I definitely agree with that, being an artist myself. When you get in that flow, it's almost divine, and you just come out with something spiritual, honestly. That's what's up. I love that, James. So you mentioned honoring yourself and not giving in to self-doubt, being present in the moment. This is kind of a detour, but it was a part of this question. But you are a successful entrepreneur. Like, how did you develop yourself as that? Because, you know, it's a lot of starving artists, but I don't feel like that's you in any way. Like, you've maintained a business for years.
You know, you know me a little bit, so some of those days were, you know, there are definitely some starving in the process, but we're not going to talk about that. But, okay. But again, I you know, when I thought broke, I was broke. When I thought that, you know, you just have moments where you just have, you know, bumps in the road, you know, at that point, it doesn't matter anymore. And again, it's just finding a way. The entrepreneur part, you know, it's all changed because everything that I thought before when I started, you know, my business and all of that, it's like all of that was thrown out the window, and I want to say the last few years. And when I thought about what makes money, what is hot here, or what's selling and this, that, and the third, like part of me, you know, it's almost like I didn't get the message, because there would be moments I would look at my contemporaries and be like, oh my God, you know, they're doing such and such, 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 you know, and I'm trying to, in a sense, keep up with the Joneses. But when I had my success, like with the Protect Her series that I did for DSC, or the Imagine Black Culture Without Detroit, which was after the store closed, they were all moments where I was in that flow of like answering a question that was out there and, you know, like in the atmosphere. So because of that, when I allow myself to just say, hey, like, you do that because you want to put this out there. And the reason I haven't really worked on DSE as much is because I don't have anything to say with DSE right now. And I don't want to force, you know, just putting out products just because, oh, well, people like it, this, that, and the third. It's like, I've been quick, you know, recently now to just say, hey, I'll put out, you know, I'll keep it open. If people want it, you know, like I'll fulfill the orders, but I'm not committed right now to DSC. I joke, I say, it's a moody teenager. It's nothing I can really do with it right now. It's a good 15 years old. It's like, it needs to figure out its own path, and I'll come back to it later when need be. But right now I have this, you know, this developing child and, you know, my create, you know, and my fine art that needs all of my attention. And, and I need to nurture it, you know, all while making sure that when DSC needs me, I guide it wherever it needs to go. So my business now is just, again, going back to being in the moment. It's like I have the skills to handle what is necessary to take care of the logistical side, but everything now these days all falls on, you know, the right side of my brain. You know, worry about creating, you know, come to the business when it's necessary.
So what is DSE for people that don't know?
So DSE is Definitive Style Exclusive, a name that came about sitting in my house trying to figure out how I could rename DSE, because originally it stood for Detroit Style Entertainment, which was something I created in college. And people knew me for DSC at that time. So I said I didn't want to change the name. And it sort of grew over time. The meaning of it now is, you know, someone who is true to themselves, their own definitive style that is exclusive to them. And I've always tried to strive when I'm creating pieces to create, you know, wearable pieces that sort of, you know, tend to that, you know, the individual, not necessarily the mass. And and more so saying that, you know, everyone has their own voice. Everyone, if they choose to, everyone has something that they can offer to the world. I've seen too many times that we follow too much of the crowd, you know, or groupthink or whatever. And it's like, not too many people have their own opinion, or they're like, hey, you know, I have this opinion because I heard it online, or I heard someone say it, not because it actually went through their mind, processed it, and then came out, you know, on the other end. So DSC is for those who choose to be their own person. So.
Love that. Yeah, it's, you free others, honestly, by being yourself. I love that. Well, let's go ahead and get into another track. Do you have a specific one, or should I just go in order?
You know what? This actually worked. Change by Donald Byrd. That actually represents the mood we're in right now. So,
okay.
Just be a wreck.
Hey guys, welcome back. Giadette here. I have a very special guest, James. Before we continue, I just want to shout people out that came through. We got past my cup. He is Detroit's finest, or we say what up though. He's up north at least. Shout out to past my cup. Rod Jack is in the house. Thank you so much for being here. Anybody else? I'm scrolling up. Gutta Beans is in the house. Thank you for being here. My boy Bat Boy Flo still in the house. And King Chronicles, what's up? I'm sure Queen was here too. Diego Blunt said so. Thank you guys for coming through. I appreciate you. And Bailey, Bobby's here. Yes, and everybody that's hanging. Hello Capricorn, Boxy Blanco, Mona M, Music. Everybody that's here, thank you so much for vibing. Tasia. Oh, and shout out to the highlighter god. So, the shady highlighter god. Anyway, James, why did you choose that song?
You know what? I was introduced to that song during a period where there was a change. Unfortunately, a family member passed away, but it was sort of a moment where during the memorial service, we had our cry, we had our moment to mourn, but at the same time, once the memorial was done, we played that song at the end. To recognize that, it's not an ending, like it's just, things don't stay the same, everything rearranges. And what's funny is that that song has now been ingrained again, another one of those songs that, I'll turn on. In fact, that was a song that I included in a playlist that I made for my solo show last year, Finding Value. And it's just the nature of the song is the fact that it really is about embracing, the inevitable, which is change. A lot of folks are, out, sometimes are not necessarily comfortable with it. And, these days now I just find myself where it's like, look, it's a part of the growth. And, with everything that's happened, just like I was talking about moving away from DSC and becoming more involved with my art. And even with my art, like I tried my best not to get caught up in, sort of a, I guess you would say a pattern. To where it's like I'm creating it like this, continuously, and just saying, you got to allow yourself to evolve and just take it a step further as far as how you choose to express yourself.
Wow, you just going in, man. I love it. Wow, I love that. Don't, yeah, you have to evolve. You can't stay the same. I agree. Definitely, cliche level up for sure. So James, what's your most exciting experience as an artist?
You know what? Honestly, it's the process, to be fair. There are times where, you have this idea in your head and you're just like, oh man, I want to get it out. I want to get it out. Like even right now, as I'm looking, there's this sketch of a piece that I plan to work on. I don't know if it's this year or next year, but it's going to be like a mammoth piece, like a 6 foot by 6 foot. And it's one of those, I believe that once it's done, we'll, really have some depth. But there's this process that I go through when I'm working, whether it's an abstract or a collage. And it was based off of a conversation I had with a family friend who came to a show, one of the last events I had at the DSC store. And I had my artwork on display. And I remember I had set up this playlist, but I forgot to bring my speaker. And that doesn't happen. Usually I always have my speaker in the shop, but that day I didn't. And I told Lester, that's his name, Lester Sloan, I wish I had the music playing, and he's like, man, your pieces are doing enough talking already. I don't need the music. And ever since he said that, that's just sort of been like the way that I approach creating is, I want to get to a place where when I look at the work, it has something to say. So it's almost so every time I find myself just saying, like it's not speaking yet, it ain't talking yet. And then, when I start to see that it's developing, I'm like, I bet, like it got something to say. It ain't there yet, but it's got something to say. And then eventually it gets to the point where it's like, yo, you talking, we talking. All right, bet, we done, we done.
You let
So,
it be speaking. I love that.
yeah.
I missed the vital moment. So you mentioned that you just did an exhibition called Finding Value. Would you like to touch more on that? Describe how that
Sure.
was.
So at the time, again, I'm going through a whole new, you know, experience. Like, you know, when you're creating at that point, you know, you're trying to enter the fine art world. No one gives a damn about what you did entrepreneur wise. In fact, there are those within that certain community who sort of shun on the commercial artists in a sense. And that's what I've been, you know, seen as, you know, like, I mean, I got, you know, artists who will remain nameless, you know, that used to be cool with me. And then as soon as I decided to go into the fine art world, barely have anything to say to me.
Wow.
It's very interesting. And this process also was something that was very shunned on, because when I was creating the collages, I started out using Photoshop to build them. And digital art, just for those who may not understand or really, you know, get, like, we embrace digital art, AI art, whatever you call it or whatever, because it is a part of our, you know, it is a part of our landscape now. But within the fine art world, it's still very much shunned upon because of the whole idea that the artist doesn't have a hand in that work, i.e. using a brush to canvas or hand to canvas. And I've been the biggest proponent of why digital art should be included, you know, within the fine art world. So that was one of the reasons that I called the show Finding Value. There were three meanings. One was because of that, to find value in the work. Once you see it in person, you'll understand why, you know, this should be, you know, should be recognized as fine art. That was one. Number two was the fact of how I was finding, you know, building my palette to build these pieces, you know, for the crowd here. So Gia was the subject for a piece that I created called Cold War. And what's interesting was that the images that I used to build that piece were from a fire that was, is actually a very well-known house, Victorian house on Cass Avenue in Detroit, next to the new Red Wings Pistons arena that was mysteriously burned down. And I went to, I think it was a Kendrick Lamar concert, and the charred remains were still there. And I found myself looking at the patterns within the remains and just started taking pictures of it. And I ended up using those images to build the collage that would end up surrounding this piece, Cold War. So I'm basically seeing things that people will overlook every single day, whether it's the textures in, you know, the ground they, you know, that people walk on, in buildings, in plant life, whatever the case may be. And I capture those images and I take those and I build these new realities within my collage pieces. So again, finding value in things that sometimes we overlook. And then ultimately it's finding value in the people and the subject matter of the works that that were created.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I need to put some snaps in the chat, y'all, because he is going deep. Value on three different levels. I love that. You're really uncovering what needs to be uncovered, bringing things, you know, to the forefront. And like you said, arguing for why things are important, specifically, like you said, just these moments in history, these untold stories, as well as, I agree with the digital art. You know, it's needed, but I can see why it's argued for in the fine art world. They want to use the paint, you know, the brush, you know, the camera. It's very, like, traditional. I understand that. But let's go ahead and play a song, you guys. Let's play a song. Do you have a specific one to follow that up?
Yeah. How Much a Dollar Costs by Kendrick Lamar.
All right, let's do it.
How much a daughter really cost? Does it cost you to go kill that brother cause he was a crip? Does it cost you to go kill that blood cause he killed that crip? You a fool, think a daughter cost you go get life in prison for killing and raping that girl. They probably gonna get the death penalty. You crazy, think a daughter cost you to go rob a bank and hold hostages. They end up losing your life when you walk out that door and think you gonna leave with all that money. You a great fool, think a daughter cost you to believe in a president that doesn't believe in his country and says some racist stuff and people that want to.
Is this not the song? James, is that the right song? James?
I'm here. That was not the right song. From To Pimp a Butterfly, Kendrick Lamar. How much a dollar costs from To Pimp a Butterfly?
Okay, let's see. Kendrick. Let's see, this is the amp of it all. And then how much a dollar costs?
Yes.
Thank you guys for letting me know that. Okay, let's see. I'm going to try this next one featuring James something. James. All right, let's try it.
Yeah.
How much a dollar really costs? The question is detrimental, paralyzing my thoughts. Parasites in my stomach keep me with a gut feeling, y'all. Gotta see how I'm chilling once I park this luxury car. Hopping out, feeling big as Mutombo. 20 on pump 6, 30 Marcellus called me Dumbo. 20 years ago, can't forget. Now I can lend them an ear or two. How to stack these residuals tenfold. The liberal concept that men do. 2006, it didn't hear me. Indigenous African, only spoke Zulu. My American tongue was leery. Walked out the gas station, a homeless man with a city tan complexion asked me for 10 grand. Stressing about dry land, deep water, powder blue skies that crack open. A piece of crack that he wanted. I knew he was smoking, he begged and pleaded. Asked me to feed him twice, I didn't believe it. Told him beat it. Contributed money, just forced pipe, I couldn't see it. He said, my son, temptation is one thing that I've defeated. Listen to me, I want a single bill from you. Nothing less, nothing more. I told him I didn't have it, then closed my door. Tell me how much a dollar cost. Staring at me, I grabbed my key. He's staring at me, I started the car, then I tried to leave. But something told me to keep it in park until I could see the reason why he was mad at a stranger. Like I was supposed to save him, like I'm the reason he homeless and asking me for a favor. He's staring at me, his eyes follow me with no laser. He's staring at me, I noticed that his stare is contagious. Cause now I'm staring back at him, feeling some type of disrespect. If I could throw a bat at him, it'll be aiming at his neck. I never understood someone begging for goods, asking for handouts, taking it if they could. At this particular person just had it down pat, staring at me for the longest until he finally asked, have you ever opened up Exodus 14? A humble man is all that we ever need. Tell me how much a dollar cost. Tripping and feeling resentment. I never met a transient that demanded attention. They got me frustrated, indecisive, and power tripping. Sour emotions got me looking at the universe different. I should distance myself, I should keep it relentless. My selfishness is what got me here, who the fuck I'm kidding? So I'ma tell you like I told the last bum. Crumbs and pennies, I need all of mine. And I recognize this type of panhandling all the time. I got better judgment, I know when niggas hustling. Keep in mind, when I was struggling, I did compromise. Now I comprehend, I smell grandpa's old medicine reeking from your skin, moonshine and gin. Nigga, you're babbling, your words ain't flattering. I'm imagining Denzel, but looking at O'Neal. Cause Sam is sad thrills, your gimmick is mediocre. The jig is up, I seen you from a mile away losing focus. And I'm insensitive, and I lack empathy. He looked at me and said, your potential is bittersweet. I looked at him and said, every nickel is mine to keep. He looked at me and said, know the truth, it'll set you free. You're looking at the Messiah, the son of Jehovah, the higher power, the choir that spoke the word, the Holy Spirit, the nerve of Nazareth. And I tell you just how much a dollar costs? The price of happiness bought in heaven. Embrace your loss, I am God.
I wash my hands, I said my grace. What more do you want from me? Tears of a cloud, guess I'm not all what it's meant to be. Shades of gray will never change if I condone. Turn this page, help me change to right my wrong.
Hey guys, Gia Dead. I have a very special guest, visual artist James Charles Morris. That was a song selected by him. Would you like to speak more about that, James?
Sure. So the reason that I chose that particular song was actually of the connection it has with a piece that I created that actually bears the same name. So I think it was 2022. I was headed down to Movement Festival, the Electronic Music Festival, to capture some photos of the crowd. And along the way, I got stopped by music that was being played in the Spirit of Detroit Plaza. And I saw this man who, you know, was, you know, you could tell he was a little bit disheveled, but he still was very stylish. He had a very interesting presence about him. And I found out that the brother's name was Grant, but he also goes by the nickname Zorro. And I captured the image of him, went about my day. And once I got home, I started going through the images that I took. And then I saw the images that I took of Grant, which were three frames. And the last frame, it was just so much power and like energy in that particular photo that I was just like, there was actually two things. One was the fact that there was a person behind him that was sort of taking away from him. But then I ended up looking at it and I said, you know what, dude, this needs to be a collage. This is your next piece. And I ended up spending, I believe, about 5-6 days working on this collage. And through this period, I also was sort of going through a personal, you know, like change. And there were moments that everything that I was like listening to or watching while I was making this piece just was hitting me. And when I finally was, you know, when I was in the final stages of completing this piece, I was looking at it and I was like, what is this going to be called? And I just sat back and I just, you know, it's like, all right, just leave it alone. And then all of a sudden I started hearing that, dun, dun. I started hearing, you know, like the chords for How Much a Dollar Costs. And one, it's one of my favorite tracks from that album, but you know how sometimes you'll hear something, but you don't really listen to it. So yeah. I turned on the song and I grabbed the lyrics and I'm reading the lyrics as I'm going along. Because Kendrick, sometimes you can miss something. And it was that last, you know, exchange where he's talking about, you know, your potential is bittersweet. Know the truth, it'll set you free. You know, you're looking at Jehovah, you know, like, you know, the Messiah. You know, if you want to know how much a dollar costs, the price for having a spot in heaven, embrace your loss, I am God. And after I'm hearing these lyrics, I just broke down crying because I knew exactly what this piece was. And I also understood what that song was about. It was about God testing your heart in a moment that you're unexpecting to see that, would you have empathy for someone or see the value in this person? Even though this person doesn't present themselves in the best manner to you in your eyes. And in that moment, I saw that, you know, that spirit in Grant that I wanted to immortalize him in that way. And when I finished the piece, I actually saw him again and showed him the piece and just told him, dude, you were my inspiration behind this piece. And he was like, man, this is all right. You know, like, and then, you know, walked on. And that ultimately was what led to the title of Finding Value, because that was the last link. And I knew that that piece was going to be the featured piece on all the promotional material and everything. But it was a lot of power in that particular piece and that moment. And and again, it's like, even thinking about it, gets me a little bit emotional, because it was a moment that it was truly just, I let go of everything and just was like, I'm a vessel at this point. Whatever you want me to do, I'm here. So
I like that, James, because honestly, you'd think that going to Movement, you'd find your collage worthy piece, but I like that you talk about this story. You like almost honor the path to your destination. You notice the little steps along the way and literally find value along the way, not just like you said, in that grand destination. So that's really cool. I love that story. And I definitely want to know which piece that is. I'm not sure which piece that is, but I'm pretty sure the audience will want to know too. So definitely send that to me so that I can put that in my story.
Most definitely.
But let's go ahead and play a few more songs. We've been slacking on the song. So do you have any specific ones? Let's play two.
Yeah, let's do Love Brings Happiness by Adrian Young and Bossa Bossa by Jimba Groove. These are two new ones that really have hit me hard. And I'm just like, man, these are some great jam, joints. So.
Okay, let's see. I think I have, all right, let's do it. Love Brings Happiness up next.
Thank you. Thank you.
Guys, I'm enjoying this. I hope you are too, James. If you guys are just joining, my name is Giadette. I have a very special artist, entrepreneur, just very talented individual. He is providing us with some grooves and just telling us about himself. Shout out to the chat real quick. So it's a couple conversations, but definitely about you. Boxy Blanco said, Gia and James, you've successfully made me feel it this Monday. And then, the Mystic Mentor is loving your selections. They said, Bassa Bassa is like hands up. It's like, it's dope. And
look,
then...
I heard that joint like about, I want to say about a week or so. No, it was recently, like maybe about 3 or 4 days ago. And I'm just like, oh my God. Like, you know, and I had to find out who is this group. I want them to be here in Detroit. I want to see them live. They are absolutely amazing. And then they ended up following me on IG. So I'm like, bet I'm going to be conversing with them for about the next little bit. So
I love that. I love that. That's so dope. So yeah, I mean, that's honestly, and I think Miss Music was saying like, when Shame's gonna, we could see you doing some shows on here, honestly. And the cool thing about AMP is that a lot of independent artists, you know, upcoming creators, we play their music. We make it go viral. Like some AMP creators, we've made them be above Nicki Minaj's new releases because we're playing them back to back. So it's the power for sure. Yeah, but speaking of viral, what is your most viral creation? Really?
Okay. You know the answer to this, man. Good times anytime you need a favor.
Seriously? Oh my gosh. Okay, do you want to so yeah, you guys put some chairs, chairs in the chat if you know what we're talking about.
Lead them in. Because look, we've only chatted about this, but you haven't, you know, verbally heard the story. So it was all by design, whatever the case may be. So, you know, for those who don't know, there was this incident that happened in Montgomery, Alabama, not too long ago, where there was a group of, you know, let's just call them, you know. I know, you know, we got some, you know, very, you know, diverse crowd here, but just some crackers being crackers, unfortunately, you know, like we decided that they were going to go ahead and like, you know, push their authority on this, you know, black gentleman who was just doing his job and thought that they were going to get away with beating him down because he asked them to move their boat that was illegally docked and they didn't want to move it. And then out of something out of, you know, like a Marvel movie, all of these, you know, like local black citizens at, you know, around Montgomery, Alabama said, we're not having this and we're going to go ahead and stand up for this brother. And what happened next was probably some of the most crazy content that's ever been put together by black folks in, you know, in the wild. And I just so happened to join the party, not because I wanted to, but because I get a call from my aunt a day after I sort of forgot about the whole incident, and she calls me up wanting to talk about it. So we're talking about it, and we're talking about the memes. And we talk about this particular photo that was remixed of the famous Ernie Barnes Sugar Shack artwork. It was shown in Good Times. It was the cover for Marvin Gaye's I Want You album, famous, you know, painting. And then all of a sudden, as I thought about that painting, that whole vision popped in my head of recreating the Good Times theme with that being at the end of it. And I busted out laughing. I'm on the phone with my aunt just like, and she's like, what's going on? I just thought, putting the Good Times theme and putting that picture at the end, I gotta call you back. And I spent the next hour like editing this video, like finding out the font that was used in the show and all of this, and then all of these, you know, different names started popping up in my head. And I said, you know, that was another moment where, you know, I ceased to exist in the moment, and, you know, like the creator took over. And that's why at the end of the video says produced by the ancestors, because they were definitely leading me. And I'm thinking, And I just wanted to do that just for myself, just to laugh, you know? And then I posted it. And I'm thinking, oh, you know, like if it gets 5,000 views, that's cool. It went to 5,000 the first day. And by the time I woke up the next day, it was at 300,000.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, I posted that in my story just now as he was speaking. So click on my globe, go to my story. It's the most current one, so you can see the video. And Music just asked, did James do an art piece on this? We need to know.
So that was my art piece. You know, like okay. it look, I can't, Viola Davis reposted it. What's my man's name? Roland Martin featured it on his show. It got a think piece in theroot.com. I'm like, and all I was trying to do was just, you know, bring that to life because I just wanted to laugh my ass off. And I'm like, well, that's my contribution, you know? And yeah, for that, you know, and for the first few days when I went out to the public afterwards, every time someone saw me, they just busted out laughing.
Wow. OMG. So you were rooting for the ancestors and the right team.
Oh yeah, I mean, right is right, wrong is wrong. And the fact of the matter is, it was wrong, you know. But the fact that, you know, there were so many who found this moment almost like it was uplifting. There was some, you know, comedic elements, you know. But it's just like, you know how we are. It's like we just take, you know, one thing and, you know, take something and just take it to a whole nother level. And you know, shout out to the brother who, you know, made that, you know, that piece, you know, the remixing the Ernie Barnes piece, which even made that vision possible. But like I said, it was just, you know, of all the things that I expect to go viral like that, I mean, I still consider it art because it definitely is an art form to, you know, to remix something like that. So you can now add meme creator to that whole list of things that you said earlier.
I love that. Yes, I love that. So let's go ahead and play some tracks, you guys. As we play tracks, go ahead and check out my story, or you can go on James's page. It says, what's the title of the reel, James?
The title of the reel, I think it's just called Good Times, but I think the actual caption of it is just like, the Lord gave me the vision, sorry.
Okay, awesome. So what song should we play next to help tell your story? I can tell you what's left.
I think No More Lies by Thundercat, that works.
Okay, let's play two back to back. And what else?
And then let's play Third Eye by Roy Ayers.
Awesome. All right.
the way it goes. My therapist told me that I should tell you the truth, and you're still angry. So sometimes I feel like I still should have lied. I tell you the truth because I care, but I also lie to you because I care. But if I tell you the truth, I guess I can sleep better at night. But then it looks like I don't care because I'm telling you the truth. I mean, I guess I'm just not a... Everybody hates when they get to that part when they realize that I don't want to tell you I don't care, but if it seems like I don't care, it doesn't mean I don't care. It just looks like I don't care. Because my emotions have been sanded off. I live in LA, sweetie. What do you expect?
Thank you.
Hey guys, welcome back. James, we can just play your selections back to back. I'm just vibing out, to be honest, and I think a lot of people are. Yo, yes, and shout out to Boxy. He said, James, you've been going crazy with these picks. And then a lot of fire emojis in the chat. Lovely Rosemarie, thank you for being here. Clouded Chris got the waves. And Sobo said Roy, and he put the fire emojis. So shout out to everybody that's here. You guys are awesome. Why did you choose those two songs? Did you talk about that?
I love Thundercat. That's another one of those, you know, you hear it right away, you're just like, all right, bet, this is going on the playlist. Roy Ayers, again, this goes back to what I was saying about, you know, songs that are spiritually uplifting and about enlightenment. Yeah, it is just, again, when you're able to vibe with something that you can just close your eyes and, like, I mean, I don't have, you know, a certain way that I meditate as far as I have to have, you know, the bowl or this, that, and the third, but if anything were a constant, it's the music. And there are days that I can just sit back. By case in point, I was putting this list together last night, and, you know, like, I always try to listen to, you know, does it flow together? And there was a moment that, like, I just fell asleep, and not because I was tired, but because I was so relaxed. And in that moment, that it's like, look, I'm done. And then what's funny was is that I was awakened once the list was done. And then, you know how Amazon Music will, like, play whatever is close to what you've put together with the playlist.
Yes.
So I think the next song that came after that was Flashlight by Parliament. And that woke me up just like, everybody got a little light under the sun. So I'm just like, yeah, all right.
That's hilarious. I love that.
I saw someone in here was like talking about, yo, you can tell G and James are from Detroit, especially with the Donald Byrd track. I'm like, yeah. Imagine black culture without Detroit. We got too many names and moments to, you know, to sleep on. Like, there's so much influence from the city. So Donald Byrd's just one of them.
I need to collab with James for the Rep Your City Marathon. We have a marathon coming up, and people are representing their states and cities. So, look, I need to go deep on some songs. But, so we got to play more tracks. We still have so many. But before we do, I want to ask you, who would you love to collaborate with? Like, you've collabed with so many artists, musicians, fellow photographers, like, so many people already. Or who would you like to collab with that you haven't already? And do you have any favorite collaborations that you've already done?
So my dream collaboration would be Andre 3000. Like, ooh. I think both me and him are sort of, you know, and it's funny because I've actually ran into him years ago. And it was one of those moments where it's like, yo, that's three stacks. And what was funny was that I looked up and he looked towards my way, said what up to me. And I actually gave him one of mine. This was back in my early, early, like, photography days, like, I think 2006. Yeah. And, you know, gave him my card, you know, like, and that was the end of that. But, you know, there's a level of freedom that he has been, you know, striving for. And the fact that this is a dude that literally is like, look, Outkast hasn't come out with an album since, I think it was the Idlewild soundtrack. But yet three stacks can get on any, like, track and immediately it goes viral. So there's a power to that. And, you know, I say, you know, if anyone ever were to come to my studio, I have this board of, like, thoughts, mantras, you know, like, most all of them just come from being in moments of meditation and, you know, like, in deep, you know, like, just, you know, really deep reflection. But there's one particular one. I totally just lost my thought. That's funny.
Okay, but I think it's fitting to go ahead and play. You have an Outkast song. Can we play that song?
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful. Liberation.
All right. I have the 8-minute version and the 5-minute. Do you have a preference? Okay, and what can we follow up with that? What can we play after that as well? Let's get some music vibes going.
Do you want to do two or three?
Let's do two.
Okay, so we'll do Liberation by Outkast, and then Love is Everywhere by Pharoah Sanders.
Okay.
There's a fine light, baby, I'm on it.
There's a fine line between love and hate. See, can't wait too late, but baby, I'm on it. There's a fine line between love and hate. You see, can't wait too late, but baby, I'm on it. Can't worry about what a nigga think to see. That's liberation, and baby, I want it. Can't worry about what another nigga think. Now that's liberation, and baby, I want it.
But you're scared to ask. Your world starts spinning. must admit, they planted a lot of things in the brains and the veins of my strain. Makes it hard to refrain from the host of cocaine, from them whores, from the flame, from a post in the game. Makes it hard to maintain focus. Then from the Glock rounds and lockdowns and burials, the seeds that sowed get devoured by the same locust. Cause it's a hard road to hoe if your ass don't move and the rain don't fall and the ground is dry, but the roots are strong, so some survive. To your surprise, now my voice they cries. You got more juice than Zeus, slinging lightning trying to frighten plains dwellers of the Serengeti, but get beheaded when you foster dreaded. Melanin, silicone, and collagen injected, dissecting my pride. Who the one gonna get it started? We be the lion-hearted, without infanticide. It's like that red sprite, you can't imagine, unless you're looking at the canvas of life, not through the peephole of mortality. Single-minded mentality, getting over on loopholes, getting paid twofold on technicalities. Clicking your heels, scared to voice how you feel, packing steel, picking cotton from the killing fields with no total. I don't think we in Kansas, no moto. Midwest or dirty south, clean dress or dirty mouth. Whether robbing preachers or killing poor righteous teachers, you a scared demon, shouldn't be allowed to spread semen. And your cowardly lines never define the jackals of Babel. Running with they pack, tail between your legs, though the mane on your head say the story. As you downplay your glory, cackling, helping the shackling of your brethren happen, just by rapping. Libertad, libertad, libertad.
Thank you.
Hey guys, Geodet, you guys are hilarious in the chat talking about what you ate for dinner. Still shouting out the highlighter god. Shout out to Emerging Nations, who's in the building. And music, we really want a profile picture. Please add one for us. But yeah, we do know what he looks like. James, why'd you choose those two tracks? Or at least the second one.
Love is Everywhere. Again, Pharoah Sanders is another contemporary of John Coltrane. It's about, you know, spiritual uplifting, about, you know, sonic vibrations, you know, and just taking us to another level. And it's funny because even when the song cuts out, you can tell that they're really starting to go into sort of the more abstract, you know, like arrangement and more, like improv as far as, you know, playing. So again, the message is clear. Love is everywhere. Love is in us all. And I'm a firm believer in the fact that, you know, when you understand what true love is, you know, then anything else that we identify as love no longer becomes relevant. And that's why I posted in there. If it doesn't elevate you, it doesn't need to be entertained, plain and simple. You know, there are too many things that unfortunately we again, going back to what I was saying earlier about, you know, trying to feel things that are empty, you know, by whether it be other people or other entities, whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. And when you find yourself in a place where you're able to, because my whole thing is that we were born in the abyss. Like we came into this world not knowing. We all agreed to these things that the world has said, this is what this is, this is what that is. And instead of, you know, being in a place where we can trust within, when we get to a place where we can identify that, like, mm-hmm. I'm in the place that I'm at right now is because I truly trusted and understood like the message and understood the language. And it's more than just prayer. It's more than just, you know, saying, hey, you know, it's one thing to believe, but it's another thing to listen and to understand where you're supposed to be placed in that particular moment. And like, even going back to what I was talking about, the piece, how much a dollar costs, you know, that piece named itself, you know, like it literally, like the title, the music from that song played in my head and then you know, basically said, like, even this piece that I just finished recently doing a piece, it was a collage, that features this woman and sort of this crazy, you know, very jumbled world, but yet she's finding peace. And literally the name Ayana came when I was taking one of my famous naps, when I'm just laying down, just become, you know, immune to whatever it is around me. And then all of a sudden I heard this, you know, sound of this woman saying, you know, my name is Ayana. And someone's telling them, say it louder. My name is Ayana. My name is Ayana. And then I woke up like, okay, the piece is going to be called Ayana's Vision.
Wow. Once again, we need to know which piece that is. So please send that to me so we can know who Ayana is, you know, visually.
Yeah.
Dang, that's what.
It's fun. It definitely, but yeah, it's like I said, I'm just enjoying, you know, the moment right now. It's beautiful.
Yes, it is. Shout out to everybody that's vibing. Shout out to my dad. He never comments, but he is in the chat. So thanks for being here, WJ. And Poker Shadow is in the building. Thank you for being here, Clouded Chris, as well as I saw somebody else. Oh, Sound Dialect. Thanks for being here as well. Wow. So we are winding down. We have maybe like 4 more songs ish to play, maybe a little more than that, actually. So let's go ahead and play a few more songs, and then you can talk about what you're doing currently and what makes you excited.
Okay, beautiful. How many are we doing this time? 2 or 3?
We can do 3. Let's go ahead and do 3.
All right, so we're going to do Tudo Que Posse Podia Ser by Milton Nascimento.
Okay.
I Am the Black Gold of the Sun, Rotary Connection, and Utopian Visions by Don Cherry.
Okay, let's do it.
All right.
Com sol e chuva, você sonhava que ia ser melhor depois. Você queria ser o grande herói das estradas. Tudo que você queria ser. Sei um segredo. Você só pensa agora em voltar. Não fala mais na porta e no anel de sapata. Tudo que você devia ser. Sem medo. Não se lembra mais de mim. Você não quis deixar que eu falasse de tudo. Tudo que você podia ser. Você ainda pensa e é melhor do que nada. Tudo que você consegue ser. Não importa, não faz mal. Você ainda pensa e é melhor do que nada. Tudo que você consegue ser.
Okay, did we play all of them? Welcome back, Chiadet. James, we are vibing out in the chat. I'm like, okay, Boxy just said it's official. This has been a Vibe 5. Thank you so much, Chia and James, for a wonderful interview, collaboration, set list. We got a couple of conversations. We're still trying to figure out the highlighter god slash homie, who that is. It's a mystery, but yes, but shout out to everybody. Music is definitely loving your taste. He's really just complimenting you on so many levels, as well as Clouded Chris. He really enjoyed it too. He said, great interview. I love the questions you asked, James. This was a Detroit ball.
So,
yes.
So.
All right. Yeah, but they're loving you, James. So I guess what's next for you? Like, what are you working on these days? What's happening in your life?
So lately, I've just been working on a new body of work for my next solo show, which will be entitled Detroit Red. There's a lot of meanings to that, but, you know, particularly Elevation, you know, Detroit Red was the street name of Malcolm Little, who eventually became known to the world as Malcolm X. And it was about, you know, in a reflection, it was about, you know, lifting himself up out of the abyss. That's something that, you know, holds very strong with me as far as spirituality, but it also goes back to my childhood because red was my favorite color growing up. Also, one of my favorite sports teams, the Detroit Red Wings. Well, red's in their name. So there's a lot of, you know, like going back in time, you know, to that innocent part of my, you know, my life. So it represents going back to innocence, but also embracing the fact that I've gone through, you know, the trials and tribulations I've had, and am working to be better every day, you know, through reflection, through learning, through experiencing and talking to the elders and talking to other people, learning from them. And yeah, it's, you know, and like I said, the music that I've been choosing and selecting, you know, reflects that. You know, there used to be a time where, and I mean, I still love hip hop, you know, so I mean, I definitely don't knock it, but it was funny. I was looking at someone answering like, yo, does James like Sexy Red, Skia, or whatever the name
of
the
song
is?
Thanks for answering that. Yes.
And I'll put it like this, to be frank, I think there's a time and a place for everything. So I don't shun anybody. I know that you know, like big thing on IG is like, yo, like this ain't representing this, that, and the third. And it's like, look, you know, everybody is a reflection of where they're at in their life. You know, like, I don't know the sister's, you know, like real name, you know, it's just Sexy Red. But if this is a reflection of what she chooses to put out, you can't sit back and, you know, like shun her, shun the society, you know, like that she's grown up in. So
yeah,
if you want to change that narrative, you better start working about changing what's going on in and around you. Cause I'm sure if she has the opportunity to, you know, and, you know, in a sense, you know, better herself.
Right. Yeah. I agree with that, you know, because yeah, I just saw something about, what is it? Kanye thought Cardi B was a part of the Illuminati, or sorry, was an industry plant when she first came out, I think because of like the lyrics of her song and what she, like how wretched she was. But I feel like to me, Cardi has kind of evolved. She still has her ways, but you know, maybe this is Sexy Red. She's coming out this way and she can evolve into something different or the same. Who knows? She could be a Sukihana too.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so I mean, you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. And plain and simple, it's like, you know, hey, anybody who, you know, is able to lift themselves up out of their craft, you know, it's like all power to them. You know, even if you don't agree with it, it's like, you know, there is that option to turn it off if you don't like it. You know, I choose to listen to what I listen to, you know, because that's my journey right now, is about, you know, going to that next level of spirituality, and the music and the material that I listen to and I absorb is my food. So, but again, there are some times where I sat back and I got to play Juvenile, back that ass up, because I'm in that mood. So
I feel you.
Yeah, so, I mean, and I got a saying, you know, some days I'm Malcolm, some days I'm Detroit Red. It just all depends on when you run into me. So.
All right. Well, how can people find you? What's the best way to contact you, to follow you? How can we find you?
So everything is real simple. My full name, James Charles Morris. That's my website, jamescharlesmorris.com. That's my IG handle, James Charles Morris. I think Twitter / X is James C. Morris Art. And, James C. Morris on here, which I'll try to be more active on AMP. You know, like, honestly, you're the reason I'm on here, because I didn't know anything about AMP. And then you keep talking about, showing you're doing these shows. And I think I got lazy because I was like, I don't feel like signing up. And then I'm realizing what AMP is. Oh, it's a, part of Amazon. So I'm like, I got Prime. Let me go ahead and sign in. And I've just been enjoying listening to some of the channels. And then I did tune in, I think it was Friday night, for your set. And I really enjoyed the vibe of the listeners and how active they are in the chat and all of that. So shout out to y'all, because I say the same thing in my IG lives. Y'all could be doing anything else. And the fact that y'all choose to spend your time on here, listening to Gia, who's doing her thing, giving her support, that y'all really, I know it's cliche, but y'all the MVPs for real. So continue to support, let people know, that she's playing great music and inviting great guests, and, let this station grow.
Thank you, James. I really appreciate that. And I think it's appropriate to just pass out an applause. I like to do that at the end of my shows, just for everybody that's listening, because honestly, the way AMP is set up, if you don't have a listener, you cannot even play music. So thank you guys for being here. Thank you, James, for being my guest. So I just want to give everybody a round of applause. Clap it up for yourself. Okay. I asked you guys if you have any questions for James, let me know. But like James said, make sure you follow him. It's James Charles Morris on all platforms. I think except he said for Twitter, it's different. And
except for Twitter. And I think you can find just James Charles Morris on Facebook as well, too.
Okay, awesome. And shout out to Alien, who just came through. LaSonya Genovese is in the building. Thank you, ladies, for being here. Make sure you guys support James, too. It's a few things that we talked about. I tried to post a few of those things on my stories so you guys can see them. He does sell prints. He sells original work. He sells clothing, so many things. Make sure you guys check out his links that he's attached to his globe. And look out for the new series, the Detroit Red series, with all those layers. Let's support artists. You know how it is here on AMP. We support each other. So let's do the same for him, too. But shout out to everybody that's here. What'd you say?
I got a shout out to Music's question. Does he listen to Doughboy Cash out of payroll? Every so often, I listen to Blue Irish Wood, and shout out to Jay Dillon. And shout out to B and she, like I said, Detroit is doing this thing. So T Grizzly, all of them. Yeah.
All right, look, you about to be my Cashed source out. For this. Yes, Cash Dow doing her thing. T Grizzly, yes, all of them. Jay Dilla and the classic Motown, yes. You're going to be my source. Shout out to James. He's going to be my cheat sheet for this marathon, y'all. So don't at me. Yes. And Claudia Chris said Detroit is on fire. Cash Dow. Yes. And Music Cap said thank you for the support. All right, y'all. So I think we are going to go ahead and end this. T Thorne 27 said great interview. Rev Mac or Claudia Chris said great interview. Oh, hello. Thanks for being here. Look,
well, daddy my parents was on, and my mama was on.
Hey, I know.
And
yeah,
shout out, shout out to my mama, you know, in Georgia right now. Shout out to her. She's just been a big supporter in all of this. So it's just, I don't know what I'd do without her. So.
Okay, well, you guys, we are wrapping this up. Thank you once again, James. If you guys don't know this profile picture, I put it especially on here because James Tickett is one of my favorite pictures. So I'm like, I got to represent for sure. Mm-hmm. But let's go ahead and ride out with your final songs. Do you have an order? I have The Star of a Story, Exodus, and Maggot Brain.
So Exodus first, The Star of the Story, and end it with Eddie Hazel's magnum opus by way of George Clinton Parliament, Funkadelic Maggot Brain.
Okay, so I'm going to play these songs and then I will end the show. Do you have any final words that you'd like to say about these selections?
So all of them have meant something to me. Exodus, just because of the material, you know, the narrative of the song itself, just listen to the lyrics, it explains itself. The Star of a Story, again, is one of those very melodic, very, you know, transcending, you know, type of track by Heatwave, probably one of their better, you know, songs. And Maggot Brain, I can tell you the story. The first time I heard that, I was doing work with my Uncle Solomon, who, you know, fortunately has passed on, but he was a very acclaimed interior designer, wallpaper and painter in the city of Detroit. And we were working on these hotel rooms, and we were listening to, I think it was 92.3, we were working late, and they played Maggot Brain, and initially I thought it was Jimi Hendrix, but then I realized it was Funkadelic, and at that time I, you know, only had heard like the R&B part of P-Funk, so I was just like, what is this? And I, you know, just was in awe of what Eddie Hazel did. And what's interesting about that track, and I'll say this and I'll let it play, was when George Clinton you know, asked Eddie Hazel to play on this track, he basically gave him a vision and told him, I want you to play like you found out your mother died. And then later you found out it wasn't true. And what happens is this 9-minute opus of just complete emotional, just like, just pouring everything out. And it, to me, is probably the greatest guitar solo ever put to record.
Okay, well, let's go ahead. I'm like, we need to play that one first now, but we'll ride out that one last. Make sure you please comment in the chat as that song's playing. You guys, thank you so much for being here. We're going to go ahead and play these last three songs, then I'll end the show. Make sure you guys follow James on all of his social media platforms, and come back for my show. I do Techno Thursday, I do Make Me Feel It Mondays, and I do Christian Hip Hop and R&B on Sundays. So all at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Boxy. Okay, let's go.
'Cause you're the star of the story I love so well. Everybody funking and don't know how. Should have seen the bull when he funked the cow. He funked so hard they saw some smoke. He said, let's get in the bed and funk like folks. Free your mind and your ass will follow. Maggot brain is a state of mind and then the condition and position of your ass. Check out the maggot brain.
Thank you.
Mr. Michael Hampton on the maggot brain, y'all. Give him a hand.
I was so fucking tonight.
Hey, y'all, we gonna be here all night, so we ain't in no hurry. We gonna turn this motherfucker out.